Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the second episode of Refugee Nights, a virtual festival from Imperial War Museums that explores different aspects of the refugee experience throughout history and celebrates their contribution to our society. In the last episode, we examined why refugees take the life-changing decisions to leave their home and seek shelter in a new country. We unpacked some popular misconceptions about the refugee crisis, and we watched a powerful artistic rendition of life beyond the conflict zone. If you missed it, you can watch it on the link below or on our YouTube channel. In this episode, we will be looking at the perilous journeys that refugees have often been forced to make across the world. How do refugees survive and create a sense of normality whilst constantly on the move and navigating the harsh realities of a refugee camp? And how have these journeys changed throughout history, from the kinder transport to the channel crossings today? This series has been made possible by our sponsors, Macfarlanes, and our partners, AHRC and ESRC. It was developed in collaboration with the Disaster and Emergencies Committee, the International Organization of Migration, and English Pen. Our media partner for this series is CNN. My name is Hassan Akkad. I am a photographer and a documentary filmmaker. I was one of the people who helped make the BBC documentary series, Exodus, Our Journey to Europe, which you may have seen in 2017. I currently live in London, making another film right now. But before I was a filmmaker, I was an English teacher back home in Damascus, where I'm from, in Syria. When Syria, which started as a peaceful revolution against the dictatorship, became a civil war and then turned into a proxy war, there was no reason, I did not see a solution in the horizon. And the decision to leave to Europe did not come easily. It was my only option. So yes, I decided to follow the footsteps of millions of other refugees who wanted to seek asylum in Europe. So I arrived to Turkey, to Izmir, which was a hotspot for people who wanted to make the crossing to Europe. And in there, I met a lot of people from Afghanistan, from Iraq, from Sudan, from Eritrea, people who were fleeing similar circumstances to mine, and people who I often made fun of when I was back home. During the Iraq War and the Lebanese conflict, people sought asylum in Syria, and I was always skeptical. I always said, why are the people here, and we're full up, and then suddenly I was in the same situation. Obviously, our passports are worthless because this is a privilege that we don't have efficient passports. We can't just book a flight and go to Europe. So our only way into Europe was on dinghies or yachts or speedboats, according to how much you can afford. So I could only afford a dinghy. So I was in a group of people with my cousin, with one of my best friends, and my other friend and his mom, and my friend's uncle and his two sons. And we got on a dinghy. It was over 60 people of us, and it was very degrading to go on a dinghy and very disappointing because I never expected that it would happen to me, and also it's not the best way of traveling because over 60 people paid around 60 grand to get on a dinghy, which eventually sank. And that's the epitome of how much humanity has failed when people have to pay that much to people smugglers in the absence of legal routes and safe routes into Europe. So our boat sank, and we had to get picked up by the Turkish Coast Guards, who brought us back to Turkey. And then on the next day, we boarded another dinghy. But this time, our boat did not sink. This time, actually, our boat was attacked. Not by thugs or mafia, it was attacked by Greek marine forces who were trying to stop boats from coming to Greece. So they attacked us, they broke our engine, stole the fuel tank, and left us midwater. And we had to swim for 7 hours and push the boat until we got to Lesbos. So our first encounter with Europe was not very promising, to say the least. We got to Lesbos, and back then it was before the Turkey-EU deal, so it was easy to get from the Greek islands where we were for only 3 days to the mainland Greece. And from there we got on buses to Idomeni up north, and from Idomeni we walked into Macedonia, where we were put on a train from southern Macedonia to northern Macedonia, and we were not allowed to disembark on stations. So we literally had to beg people on platforms to fill our water bottles and bring us water. I always imagined that I would want to do a Euro trip once when I lived in Syria, and this wasn't the kind of trip that I imagined that I would do. And it was disappointing because Europe to me and Britain are the beacon of human rights and equality, so it was disappointing to be treated like that. We got to Serbia where we walked for like 20 hours until we got to the first village, and then from there we got buses to Belgrade, and we had to find smugglers to get us through Hungary, because Hungary is the treatment of refugees in Hungary is notorious, and they detain people in containers and they force them to give their fingerprints. So we were smuggled by the Serbian mafia, actually. We paid 1,200 euros each to get to Austria, to Vienna. From Vienna, most people wanted to go to Germany or Sweden or Holland, so it was pretty easy to get there on a train or in a bus. But I wanted to get to Britain merely because I could speak English and it will be easier for me to integrate. Having gone through so much traumas, I wanted somewhere where I can just, you know, I hit rock bottom and I wanted to start over easily. So I got to Calais, and Calais is famous for being the access point into Britain. It took me 28 days to get to Calais, but the rest, I spent 2 months sleeping in parks, in the jungle camp for one night actually, and in Dunkirk camp, and outside a church. It was the hardest bit of the journey, and every day I would try to sneak into lorries and get smuggled on ferries to Britain, but we would fail. We would try the train, the freight train, to jump on the train and then get through the Eurotunnel to get to England. But it was difficult. It was almost impossible. And throughout this whole journey, I was filming my entire travel because I wanted people to watch it. There was so much rhetoric, which I read online, about people saying, oh, we're here to steal the jobs, or we're here because it's an Islamic invasion, or we're coming to establish Sharia law. And there was so much, I felt like there was a lack of understanding of why we were doing these journeys. So I documented my entire trip, and hoping that I will build some bridges and to help people understand these journeys. And also it's worth highlighting that it was not possible to do it without social media and the internet in general, because 99% of the information where we can get a bus, or which smuggler to contact, or where to stay, was on social media platforms, on Facebook and mainly. And to also helped us stay in touch with our families. So social media really like changed the face of the refugee crisis compared to other waves of refugee crises in the past. And after 60 days in Calais, I managed to get a fake passport, which was Bulgarian. And my name was Tresho Anatoliev Trianov. It took me a whole week to memorize it. And I managed eventually to fly from Brussels to London, to Heathrow, where I immediately claimed asylum as a Syrian. I was screened, I was questioned, I was interrogated. And I was granted political asylum after 6 months, given my case and where I come from. And then I had to embark on a whole new journey, which is often not talked about, and it's life in exile. The next clip is one I feel very strongly about. It's a discussion about the infamous Calais jungle and how the arts can shine a light on refugee stories. I'm standing next to the original Calais cross from the Eritrean Orthodox Church of Saint Michael, one of the longest standing structures in the refugee camp. It really brings home the need for hope and community in difficult times. The conversation features a very special guest who you might have seen in a few films, like Sherlock Holmes and the Grand Budapest Hotel. Tune in and find out who. Welcome to this conversation, which IWM is staging about the famous Calais jungle, which existed up until October 2016. In northern France, there's always been a camp, a makeshift camp, where people who wanted to make the crossing to the UK got there to basically make the crossing here, the
the final stage of their trip. Now, at one point, the camp in 2016 was the largest refugee camp in Europe. It had over 10,000 people from everywhere, basically, from Afghanistan, Syria, Iraq, Eritrea, Ethiopia. And I also happened to be in Calais for 2 months when I myself made the crossing from Syria to Britain. I stayed there for 2 months. I couldn't stay in the jungle. I was there maybe for a couple of days because there are two eras in the jungle. There's the time before the picture of Alain Kurdi, which changed the face of the refugee crisis, went. And Alain Kurdi is the Syrian toddler who washed on the Syrian coast, on the Turkish coast. So before that picture went viral, I was in Calais and there was hardly anyone there except for a couple of charities. It was pretty messy. There was no infrastructure, hardly any toilets. But I was there when the picture went viral, and I saw the amount of the number of people who flocked down to the jungle and wanted to help. And it was incredible. It became the charities and the people, the grassroots, basically built shelters and toilets and helped people with all sorts of stuff to be able to live in that camp. It was not pleasant at all. Like my 2 months in Calais, I described Northern France. I described jungle as the graveyard of hopes, because quite a lot of people would get there hoping to get to England, but would not make it. So it's doesn't bring out a lot of good memories. And I am I'm incredibly honored and proud to be having this conversation with three fantastic people, who each of whom have their own personal connection with the jungle at one stage in their lives. And I would like to introduce Jude Law, I don't know how to introduce you, Jude, award-winning filmmaker known for his films in The Young Pope, the Sherlock Holmes, the Grand Budapest Hotel. And it was so good to see you, man. It's been a while. And Joe Murphy and Joe Robertson, playwrights and founders of the Good Chance Theatre, an art organization that builds temporary theatres in form of large domes in areas where expression is stifled and where immigrant and local communities are struggling to integrate. Great to see you both, Joes.
Hey, Hassan.
My first question is about your personal connection with the Calais jungle. What connection do you have with the camp?
Well, we lived there for 7 months in the period that you described, 2015 to 2016, and around that time that you described, that the photograph of Alain Kurdi on the beach in Bodrum, and we were a part of that wave of volunteers, as kind-hearted individuals who went over to try and do something. And actually, we didn't even go over intending to do anything. We went over intending to travel on to further into Europe, to Munich, where Angela Merkel had opened the borders to people from Syria at that time. And we went, I suppose, as artists, as citizens, with the intention of bearing witness to this awful thing that was happening in Europe and across the Mediterranean and the Aegean at that time, because I suppose the questions that we were asking about this mass movement of people, you know, simple questions about who those people were, where they were coming from and where they were going, weren't being answered. We were seeing hysteria and confusion and shock in the newspapers and on TV and on Twitter. So for us, it was an attempt to bear witness. We didn't expect to really stay in Calais. We expected to stop because we'd heard there were a group of people there. And what we found was a kind of town of at that time, about 10,000 people, 25 different nationalities of people living together, waiting, and also building.
And building a lot that you associate with any kind of town, and, you know, anywhere across the world. And you know, building against will. You know, nobody wants to have to build in a situation like the one in Calais, as you described, Hassan, but people had to, and people had to make a community there. And as Joe said, and as you said, Hassan, there were people from many different countries and many different languages. And so the idea of making a single community out of people from many different places is a difficult one. And that's where we thought that art comes into play. It's art is something that brings people together, that, you know, creates a kind of impression of the world and helps us understand different cultures. And so when we got there, we decided, together with lots of people that we met in the camp who were there as refugees, to build a theatre. And we filled it together with art from all different forms. And that became really our kind of contribution. And that's where we met you, and that's where we met Jude as well.
Turn left onto David Cameron's Avenue. Stop at the sauna. Catch a play at the theatre. Service at the church. Khutbah in a mosque. Before arriving at Salah's restaurant in Afghanistan. When does a place become home?
I don't know about you, but what struck me when I got to the camp, when I got to Calais, is that I didn't expect that there would be a camp like this in Western Europe, especially in France. Because I, coming from the Middle East, I always thought like the, you know, Europe, Britain is the, it's just like the cradle of human rights. And I did not expect that when I got to the camp that it would be that terrible, to be honest. So I'm just wondering what struck you when you made that decision that we want to go out and help. What struck you the most when you got there?
I think we were, like you, shocked that a camp like that could exist an hour from London. That, you know, on the border of two of the richest countries in the world, you had a refugee camp with conditions worse than any refugee camp in the world. When we arrived, there were no toilets. There was no adequate system for feeding people. There was no adequate shelter for housing. And, you know, the governments on both sides of that border were doing nothing. And that's why in that gap, the effort volunteers from small NGOs, sort of very dynamic small organizations, and organizations that just sprouted up that are now major humanitarian organizations in Europe, like Help Refugees, Care for Calais, you know, all these great, great organizations doing great work, had to fill that gap because there was just no official provision whatsoever. And we were shocked and appalled that it was on our doorstep. And just the second thing that struck me was related to that, and, you know, to the conditions. Everything apart from those things, everything we'd heard about the camp was wrong. I think we were taught from every media report we'd seen that it was, you know, a dangerous sort of scary place with very dangerous, scary people. And, you know, it was dangerous for the people who lived there, but the people who lived there were, for the most part, incredibly, incredibly talented, skillful people with complex stories, complex reasons for traveling, complex reasons for being there. And from our perspective, incredible artistic traditions, cultural traditions, you know, narratives and voices that needed to be heard. So that was a big surprise for us, I think, the humanity that we found in the camp.
So you did that for 7 months, and but then the camp was got taken down. They demolished the camp. So what next? What did you do after that?
Well, then we thought, you know, we've got to find a way of representing this, of telling a story about this place. It is such, as you say, an extraordinary thing to have happened, extraordinary in amazing ways and extraordinary in horrible ways. And we thought, we've got to write about this, we've got to create something about this, because the people who didn't make that hour journey from London to Calais need to find a way of understanding this, of feeling this. And so we thought the only way to do this is to get together with people who were there and to create a piece of theatre. So we wrote together, Joe and I wrote a lot, and then we spoke with people who we'd met and worked with in the theatre and who were now in the UK, and we created a cast that was, I think, maybe 15 different nationalities in that company, because there simply had to be to represent that place. And, you know, we created a piece of theatre together that we're all very, very proud of, that has toured the world, and I think is a fair representation of the complexity and the surprises that existed in that place and still do.
I thought it was stunning, the jungle. I think I went twice. you've done an incredible job at replicating it in London, and I loved the diversity of the cast, and you really nailed it. Jude, I think a lot of people don't know that you did have some sort of a connection with all of this, with the Good Chance Theatre in Calais. Mm-hmm. So do you want to tell us a little bit about that? How did you get involved, basically?
I'm really going to echo a lot of what Joe said. My visit was shorter, but came about through the same need to see and experience and feel and interact with the people in this camp that was, again, as Joe said a moment ago, just an hour or so outside of London. It's a part of the world, Calais, that you know, all Brits sort of know if they've ever traveled into Europe. So it always feels very familiar, and here it was on the news. And again, as Joe said, there were all these reports of this scary, dangerous place. I'm someone who I like to see things with my own eyes, and what I read between the lines was that there was an awful lot of neglect and an awful lot of problems, and I wanted to see it and see if there were. It wasn't a case of see if there's anything I could do. I certainly didn't go there initially thinking, oh, I can help here. I just really wanted to feel it and meet the people there, and so I went. With my friend Josie, who was one of the initiators behind Help Refugees, and at the time really was I think she thought she was doing this as a temporary sort of stopgap before the bigger humanitarian organizations would come in. Of course, that was many years ago now, and she's still there and still doing it and still working unbelievably hard with all the good folk who are behind Help Refugees. And I arrived, and again, echoing really what Joe and Joe said, I was just so shocked that it was so that there was this attempt to build something semi-permanent, because it, you know, I imagined it was going to be a place where people were passing through, but indeed it immediately struck me that goodness no, people are living here, are attempting to live here, because they are being told they can't go back and they can't go forward. I was shocked at the state of the place. I was shocked also at the civility of the place, that it felt at times like a very exotic and exciting place. Weirdly, there was delicious food being made, and barbershop, and a place of worship. But then the thing that really upset me the most was the presence of hundreds and hundreds of children who were on their own, running around these temporary streets and unaccounted for, and people, good people, trying desperately to herd them together or look after them, each of them individually wanting to try and make the leap across the channel, all of them having seen awful, awful things. So there were just so many loose ends and so many stories and affecting interactions that I was really quite overwhelmed and didn't know. I went back a couple of times just to sort of take it all in, and a couple of those were my own little attempts at trying to do something. I helped with bits and bobs, whether it's to do with food or giving things out and so on. And I think it was the second time I heard about and saw and was drawn to this theatre, naturally, because I'm an actor, and I was quite amazed. I'd missed it. I was like, there's a theatre here. And there was this wonderful center of creativity and storytelling and shared interaction, shared communication. And I just happened to probably be there the one day Joe and Joe weren't there. I think they'd gone to get resources. Or they'd gone to do something. So I remember sort of kicking about this place saying, who do I talk? I want to do something here. Like, this is my language. This is maybe something I can do. But eventually I did make contact, and it struck me at the time that another good sort of soul, a friend of mine who I knew would feel and understand this situation and maybe try to do something that wasn't like a sort of a band-aid on a wound. It was more trying to do something that maybe communicated something human to those who maybe didn't understand what was going on, but also to put a human face to the people that were there. And that was through this idea of reading letters. So we used the Good Chance as a venue to host a Letters Live event, which involved people coming over from London, some poets, some musicians, some actors, and reading letters alongside people who were living in the camp, who were reading their own words, explaining why they were there, or sometimes maybe just sending out words to families at home. And Letters Live is the common link between all of us. And they've been a really big supporter of Good Chance, but also of trying, as I said, to spread the word. So really, I mean, I have so much admiration and respect and love for Joe and Joe and what they do, because they've also seen it absolutely through. I really didn't want to be someone who, you know, a lot of good people go to, went to the Calais jungle and they did good things, but the problem is still alive. You know, the jungle isn't there, but the issue is. And telling that story and maintaining this kind of dialogue to me is really what's at the heart of the problem. And going back on something I said, putting a human face and a human voice to the problem. And I think that's something the arts can do very well, because we share our stories, we touch each other, we expose ourselves with vulnerability and humor and drama, and try to make connections, you know, with other people through the arts.
Thank you, Jude. That leads me to literally to my next question about the role of art and theater in crises like the refugee crisis. Because while builders can go and build toilets and chefs can go and cook meals and stuff, what role do artists play in these crises? Because there's this myth that people is like giving voice to people. People already have voices. And what you were saying, Jude, is about platforming voices. It's about putting face on crises. But what other roles can art and theater play in crises like this?
First of all, without broadening this issue, because obviously we're talking specifically about the refugee crises, but it's interesting, isn't it, that during this time, certainly in Britain, where the arts are surviving by the skin of their teeth, they're still being considered as a sort of luxury, as something that, oh, you know, you do. That we do if we behave well, or we do if, you know, we've got the money, rather than seeing them as an actual integral part of who we are and what we are and how we communicate, how we share experience. And yet again, we're sort of fighting for its life. And in a way, there's an interesting symmetry with the arts trying to survive during the pandemic, both in Britain and around the world, but also the vital role they play in trying to bridge gaps between communities and indeed people in more comfortable circumstances and people in less fortunate circumstances. It plays a vital role from my point of view. I think what you share through the spoken word, the written word, visual arts, is a sort of universal language of imagination, of spirituality and emotion, and it is boundaryless. It's a something that touches the very essence of who we are and goes all the way back So when we sat around fires, scared of the dark, and trying to put our children to sleep in the caves of old, you know, I mean, it's that old and that important. And something that old and that important has great potency and great power. I guess you could also then add to that that of course the modern equivalent is to go off what you said, Hassan, a platform. We have to embrace, I suppose, modern elements, and the modern elements are that, you know, the media and spreading word and trying to get charity or donation or help requires platform, and the arts are often a very good way of, and a very honest way of demonstrating that without politicizing it.
Yeah. And on that note, I would like to tell our viewers that both Joes have not stopped with the jungle. They're working on an amazing new project, Amal. So do you guys want to tell us a bit more about it?
It's a wonderful project. Tell us a bit about it.
So we're next year are walking from Gaziantep, which is on the border of Turkey and Syria, all the way to Manchester in the United Kingdom, and we'll be passing through many, going through towns and villages and cities, and we'll be walking with a young girl called Amal. And the only difference between Amal and the many hundreds of thousands of unaccompanied kids who have arrived in Europe in the last few years is that Amal is a giant, beautiful, 4 meter tall puppet who will be brought to life by an incredible team of artists from lots of different backgrounds, people from across the route and from all of the countries that we've talked about in the jungle, and they will bring her to life all across the route and bring people together. It's just what we've been talking about, and we'll all be outdoors.
Is there a way of following it and kind of joining in? Do you know what I mean? I mean, whether it's online or as it comes through a community, or you know what I mean? Are there sort of interactive events as she and you pass through communities?
Absolutely. So in every village and town and city, there will be artistic events made by people along the way, whether that's in a school or a mosque or a church. And if you live anywhere along the route, you're welcome to come and walk with us to be a part of those artistic events. If you're not exactly along the route, there are multiple ways of getting involved and joining the walk. It's called Walk with Amal, and you can search on Google and find all the ways that you can to join in.
It's called Walk with Amal.
Walk with Amal.org.
It is definitely true that we need art and culture now more than ever to see us through difficult times. That was Jude Law, Joe Robertson, and Joe Murphy from the Good Chance Theatre. Next, we're going to head over to Refugees Forced to Flee, a new exhibition at IWM London, which explores a century of refugee experiences from the Kinder transport to the Calais jungle. Let's hear from curator Iris Veysey, who will be talking about one of our exhibition's highlights.
Thank you, Hassan. This is Constellations, which is a new installation by artist Indra Serpetita. Indra's a Lithuanian artist who is now based in London, and we commissioned her specially to create new work for this exhibition, Refugees Forced to Flee. And each of the artworks engages with some of the more intangible themes that runs through the exhibition, so ideas like home, agency, and identity. So Indra has represented 7 different refugees' journeys as neon constellations. Each circle and line denotes a stop and start along the way. And what you can see when you look at the constellations is that some of the journeys are longer, some are shorter, because some people get stuck along the way. Sometimes the constellation loops back on itself because somebody's had to go backwards. Indra is interested in exploring ideas about journeying and communication. Today we tend to think that everybody has a mobile phone and most people must be finding their way digitally. But actually, there have been reports of smugglers and refugees using stars as a navigation tool. So the neon constellations here allude to a more universal language of astronomy, and also, of course, to a much longer history. Even though these are recent journeys that have been made, by using the language of stars, Indra alludes to a much longer history of journeying and migration. Each of these journeys is taken from a research project called Crossing the Mediterranean Sea by Boat. This was an ESRC funded project. It was an international project. It was led by researchers at the University of Warwick. And by doing this, they explored the physical and bureaucratic barriers that refugees face, and the effect of migration policy in the EU on refugees trying to make that journey.
Good evening. Imagine leaving everything that you know and love for a perilous journey into uncertainty and places where you may not be wanted. What shapes that decision to leave home, and how do you put down roots in an unfamiliar place? So in this episode, we're looking at the journey, and I'm delighted that we have here two brilliant speakers of very different ages, if I may say, who have both made very different journeys as refugees at very different times in history. They're both people that I know personally and admire greatly, so it's a great pleasure. So first of all, I'd like to introduce Nujeen Mustafa, who is a Kurdish Syrian refugee and activist. And she was raised in Aleppo in Syria and gained attention after traveling 3,500 miles across Europe by wheelchair, fleeing the Syrian war, and arriving finally and resettling in Germany, where she joins us from today. And she's the co-author, actually with me, of The Girl from Aleppo, Nujeen's Escape from War to Freedom. And then I also have joining us Alf Dubs, Lord Dubs, who is a Labour Party peer and former MP, who came to Britain from Prague on the Kinder transport back in 1939 and has campaigned tirelessly and prominently for unaccompanied refugee children to be given safe passage to the UK. So I'm going to start by asking each of our speakers to talk for about 5 minutes, describing their journey fleeing and what it was like. So if I could start with you, Alf, please.
Okay, fine. You did say 1939 I came, I think. Did you? Oh, yeah, okay. Right, well, I was 6 years old, living in Prague. The Nazis, my father's Jewish, my mother wasn't. And the Nazis occupied Prague in March 1939. My father disappeared immediately. My mother tried to get permission to leave and was refused. And so she put me on a Kinder transport. Before I got on the train, we had to tear a picture of the Czech president out of our school books and stick in a picture of Hitler and all that. And I can see in front of me anxious parents, Prague station. I was about the youngest on that train. I think it was July 1939, about the youngest. And the train went off. Eventually, German soldiers in the background on the platform and so on. We got to an interminably long journey, hard wooden seats. But when you're 6 years old, you don't mind that. You don't notice that. We got to the Dutch border, and the older ones cheered. I was, as I say, one of the youngest, if not the youngest. They cheered because we were out of reach of the Nazis. I was looking for windmills and wooden shoes, which is all I knew about Holland. But I did know it was significant that we got to Holland. I didn't understand why. And then a night boat from Harwich, from the Hook of Holland to Harwich, and then by train to Liverpool Street. Now look, compared to what Nujeen went through, that was easy. You know, that was pretty easy. Traumatic a little bit, but it was easy because I was on a train. I think what was good was that for me, it saved my life, because if I hadn't gone on the train, I don't think I'd have survived the Holocaust. So to that extent, it was quite traumatic. But at the time, the journey was fairly straightforward. It wasn't a long journey. It was about 48 hours. And I was also luckier than most, and I had somebody waiting to meet me at Liverpool Street, which was incredible. Some of the other people on the Kinder transport saw their relatives years later, sometimes never at all. So I was luckier than many of them.
Nujeen, can you tell us a little bit about your journey?
So after the breakout of the war, we were displaced for multiple times. First, we were in the eastern countryside, and then ISIS was threatening the town. So it was this journey had multiple stages. And then there was this stage in Turkey, and it didn't go out very well. We we resolved just to leave because there was nothing on the horizon for the family, and we could have stayed there for a decade and nothing would have changed, because at the end of the day we were an unwelcome guest in that country. And for a person with disability, there are no prospects of the future in there. So me and my sister decided to embark on this journey to Europe through the Balkan Road. And my brother had already been there for a few months, and I missed him terribly at the time, and I just wanted to see him. Of course, we were aware that I had to do it in a different way, and that my situation was a bit unique because I had to do it in a wheelchair. But of course, I was not going to, you know, across the whole continent without my wheels. I believe I had a lot of my firsts in this journey. So I had been on a train for the first time, on a ferry for the first time, on a plane for the first time, at TNC for the first time. It happened in quite an unusual way, but I wouldn't say that I regret it. There was a lot of danger, and I think it broke my heart that my people, proud, successful, and peaceful and happy, were brought to this point where they had to assimilate some kind of exodus just to survive and start a new life. But I firmly believed in my right to have this opportunity to start a new life, because what I had back then was only fear and stress and just anxiety. So but I didn't want to grow up like that. I didn't want to expect my death every other day. So we crossed 8 borders, if you count Germany, of course we crossed in a rubber dinghy, and it wasn't that easy from Turkey to Greece. It wasn't fun. It was like late afternoon. The waves were very high. We had a very salty shower in there. There were 38 people in there with 11 children, if you count me. I was 16 at the time. But you know, with tears and prayers and determination, we made it after a month. And of course, we made it to Germany there. And there were also some positive aspects, as I would call them, because for the first time, instead of me relying on other people's assistance, my group was relying on me to speak English and assist them with officials.
Can you explain to people how you learned your English?
Yeah, so I watched the soap opera Days of Our Lives. It was subtitled, and I watched it for about 2 years. So it was a sufficient time for me to learn. But yeah, it was quite nice to feel useful and, you know, have people rely on you instead of always relying on others. So it had its positive aspects. And back in Syria, I would barely leave my apartment because it was not accessible for someone with a wheelchair, and I lived in a 5th-floor apartment with no lift. So I would be in a self-imposed quarantine, very similar to what we have now.
That really gives some sense to people of just how difficult the journey is. Lord Dubs, can you tell me, when you came on your journey, was there anything you brought with you from home?
I don't think so. I had a little suitcase, nothing really. My mother had packed a little backpack, a little knapsack with some sandwiches, which apparently I didn't touch the whole journey, but I don't remember anything. I mean, I may have had one or two things, but nothing I'm aware of. No, nothing at all.
Nothing to remind you of home.
Nothing at all. No.
Nujeen, what did you bring? Did you bring anything with you?
We also had a backpack, but I also don't don't remember bringing anything from home. I was feeling too guilty to, you know, dare to bring anything along from home because I was leaving, and I knew that I may not return for decades. So I was feeling too guilty to, you know, dare to bring something along.
You did have one thing which almost every refugee I meet seems to have today, without which I don't think you can make the journey, which is a mobile phone. How do you think, which obviously, Lord Doves, you didn't have.
Mobile phone.
What difference do you think that has made in terms of facilitating the journey and also being able to share the experiences?
Of course, it has made us more self-reliant, I would say. So you would just look up a GPS location and, you know, see where all the groups are heading. Of course, it was at the time it was the peak of the refugee crisis, so you wouldn't find it hard to follow along with a group of people. But it has definitely required a lot of recharging in the phone grids, and, you know, just spending a lot on mobile data just to have access to the internet when you're on the way. But I would definitely say that it increased our self-reliance, and we didn't ask so much for the way as would have been expected.
Both of you had to leave your parents behind. Lord Doves, can you talk a little bit about the psychological impact of the children, that you were so young to leave their parents behind?
Well, I don't know that I can. You know, these things happen. One is 6 years old. Fate just takes one along. It was quite shocking saying goodbye to my mum. On the other hand, you know, as I say, I was luckier than most. I did have somebody waiting for me at Liverpool station. I mean, my father died soon afterwards, but nevertheless, he was there waiting for me. So I suppose it was more that things were happening and I didn't fully understand them. You know, I was 6 years old, and the German soldiers everywhere and all that, and quite traumatic for my mother. But I don't think I really fully engaged with all that. I think at the age of six, things just happened to one.
And Nagin, I mean, your parents are still now in southern Turkey, aren't they? I know you miss them.
Of course, it's quite different when you leave at 16 instead of six. I was quite aware that, you know, this was, you know, the longest separation I would have from them, and I'm the youngest, and the one who was always spoiled and taken care of by the parents, and I just got used to them as a constant presence in my life, and now it kind of just forced me to grow up too quickly in the span of the 5 years, and it, I think that. But I always justify that, or just try to explain it to myself by saying that everything that I have now, you know, you pay taxes for every privilege or every service that you procure everywhere, and the tax for everything that I have now, being able to go to school, living in a free country, living in a war-free country above all, is having to be separated from my parents. So I have to just make sense of what happened and try to live with it, because so far now I've been unable to do anything about the separation. So it requires a lot of coping mechanisms to move on with your life here.
And you talked about the long journey that you made through nine countries, and of course you did it in a wheelchair. I mean, it's hard enough for anybody to make that journey able-bodied. You've since become an advocate for disabled refugees, and you talk about it at at the UN and various places. Can you tell us a little bit about the particular difficulties that disabled refugees face?
Of course, disabled refugees are a group that are forgotten in times of peace. The situation even worsens in times of war. So, I arrived at a refugee camp that was not at Mori, actually, that was not accessible for me at the time. There was no accessible restrooms for that, and I had to go to the complementary one where there were multiple cases, people with disability who needed that and who used the accessible restroom that was there. And but I was shocked how overlooked the group is, even though people who flee war, and the percentage of disabilities, increases when there's a conflict going on. So you would have someone with an amputated arm or a leg, or someone who's lost his hearing or sight. So I was increasingly frustrated with how overlooked the issue of refugees with disabilities was. And that, of course, that gave me the opportunity to nudge decision makers on the elbows and, have the privilege of speaking in a lot of, public, very influential platforms like the UN Security Council, and just to highlight and mainstream the issue of refugees with disabilities. And it has been quite a pleasure and an honor for me to do that.
So, and you talked about Moria, Nujeen. I believe Lord Dubs, you visited Moria
I
was going to just ask, the conditions there were so bad. Maybe you could describe what you found and what the world should really be doing about this.
Well, it was about 18 months ago. At that time, I think there were about 10,000, 11,000 people in the camp, originally designed for, I think, 2,000. There was an overflow camp nearby, or two overflow camps nearby. I thought the condition was shocking. There was overcrowding. There was no safety. Young people were in danger. And there was a sense of despair about the place as well. If I can just tell a little story. I went to Jordan about the same time. And Jordan has a refugee camp called Zatari, which has 80,000 people in it. But it's got water sanitation, it's got proper buildings, well, prefab buildings and so on. So it's comfortable physically. And I was talking to a young boy, 17, and he said he just finished his education in the camp. And he said to me, I said to him, "And what are you going to do now?" He said, "I can't get a job in the camp. I can't get a job outside the camp. What do I do?" And it's this lack of hope. Now, I think people can put up with terrible conditions if there's a little bit of hope for them. But where there is no hope, it is awful. And I felt that in Moria there was no hope at all. People were just there, and they had no sense of looking forward to a way out or getting anywhere at all. Absolutely depressing.
You introduced the Dubs Amendment to bring in unaccompanied children. I don't know what the latest numbers are, how many have come in, but can you tell us a little bit about that and what has been achieved?
Well, there were two separate amendments. In fact, the first one was for us to take unaccompanied child refugees who were in Europe, mainly from Greece and some from Italy, mainly Greece and northern France. And that, after some objections, went through, mainly because public opinion became supportive when people knew what was going on. And they'd seen some of the terrible pictures of people drowning in the Mediterranean. And Alan Curdy, the little boy, was drowned on a beach. So that galvanized opinion. And the government said arbitrarily we'll stop it at 480, which is what it is. The more important issue is the Dublin Treaty, under which children in one EU country can join relatives in another EU country. And we've been working very hard to try and have that continue beyond the point of end of the transition period, when we're fully out of the EU in every sense. And that is an argument that is still going on. I could spend an hour talking about it. But we've got an amendment which covers both lots of children, and that was passed in the Lords. It's off to the Commons on Monday, and then it's coming back to us, and we'll have to see what happens. And I'm hoping some of the Commons people are tough enough to actually support the amendment.
There's recently been talk about trying to stop the dinghies crossing by having warships patrolling the channel or putting nets to try and stop their propellers. Do you feel that the UK is a less welcoming place today for refugees than when you came?
Well, I think so. Well, mind you, there were arguments even when I came. If one reads the Hansard, the parliamentary debates at the time, there were also some objections. But and don't forget, in 1938-39, Britain was pretty well the only country that took kinder transport children. It took 10,000 from Germany, Austria, and Czechoslovakia. And even the Americans said they can't because it's additional to quota. So, but really, it's less welcoming now. We were okay with the Hungarians. We were not bad with the Vietnamese, or even with the East African nations. And then it sort of got hotted up a bit. But I think, frankly, some of the latest ideas: warships in the channel, nets to stop boats to clog up the propellers of these dinghies. I mean, this is absolutely. It'd be laughable if it weren't so tragic that this is all being done to stop a handful of people seeking safety. Point is, if they come by a legal path, they won't resort to dinghies. They come on dinghies because there's no other way for them to get over. And if they have family over here, of course they desperately want to come. I mean, what other future do they have? So it's and by the way, can I just say, as far as Nagin is concerned, some of us are also supporting legislation that if there are children here, they should be allowed to be joined by their parents. That would deal with your situation if you had similar legislation in Germany. Because again, I think that is such a cruel separation for you to be in safety in Germany and to have your parents somewhere in Turkey. I think that's such an unhappy, miserable situation. And I think all countries in Europe should change their laws so that when a child is here, close family can join them.
Eugene, you've spoken very eloquently in the past about refugees being people, not numbers. How do you think that we can get people to care more about this issue, either through the media or through institutions like the museum?
I think that it falls on us to be an active part in the process of humanizing the refugee crisis, to maybe, I mean, for the interest to be increased and for people in Europe and everywhere in the world to see the similarities more than the differences between the two groups. I think it falls on us to just carry this responsibility of speaking up and showing that we are also that we are also very similar and we want the same things. We want future for our children. We want safety. We want a job. We want, we don't want to live in danger. It has to happen on both sides. It's not a one way process. So I think it has to happen in a way that encourages both parties to talk to each other, come closer in a way, and understand why the other party might be apprehensive or reluctant to accept the other. So, for example, many factors play into the reluctance that is shown in Europe and in European countries to receiving refugees. You'd say that There's a lot of cultural, religious, and just everyday differences. There's a lot of what the other party might not understand about the other, and that's where it should be attempted to build the bridge, between the guest and its host. Refugees are guests. They're not problem that needs solving. They're not a burden on anyone's shoulder. They're, you know, they're just someone who is trying to rebuild his life. So,
yeah. I think that's, unfortunately, we don't have much more time, but that's a good way to finish. Can I just ask you both one quick parting question? Lord Dubs, when you came, what was your dream of what you might be? Did you ever dream that you would end up being a lord?
Oh, good gracious me, no. I got passionately interested in politics when I was about 13 or 14. I think I did that because I thought, well, if politics, if evil men in politics can do such harm, maybe politics can be also used to reverse the process. But my ambition was, my highest ambition was to become a local councillor, and which I did. And then I met a friend who was an MP, and he said, "Oh, have a go, have a go." And I said, "But how can I? You know, English is my third language, and I'm a refugee and my background." And so, no, he just said, "Have a go," and eventually it worked. It worked. And I'll just tell you one story if I can. In the 1970 election, I was a Labour candidate for the Cities of London and Westminster, Central London. And my Tory opponent was Christopher Tugendhat. So you had a refugee from Vienna competing with a refugee from Prague for the central constituency in London. And the media never picked it up. But I thought, in what other country could that happen? I thought that was fantastic.
That's great. And Nadine, when you arrived, you said you wanted to be an astronaut. Is that still your dream?
Of course it is, but there has been a few setbacks to that. I would still work on it because I figured out that after being schooled finally here, figured out that I was not proficiently good enough at math to work in the science field. But it's still a dream that is going to be worked on. But when I arrived, I just I wanted to be an astronaut eventually, but I just wanted to, you know, resume the life of a normal 16-year-old with, you know, to attend school eventually, of course, and to, you know, build a new life here, of course, to learn German and be able to go to converse with everybody. But of course, that's not how it turned out, of course, for me, because as my German guardian used to say, we have the first celebrity refugee ever. I arrived here with a lot of, it happened to, you know, trigger a lot of media attention. So I tried to use it in a way that would, you know, with writing the book, of course, you know, that I just wanted to people to know that refugees were humans and not numbers. I wanted to highlight what it means to be a disabled person in Syria, what it means to be a refugee, and I'm eternally grateful to have that voice, and I'm going to continue to use it for you know to make the world a better place.
Thank you. Well, I think we couldn't have two better examples of what refugees can bring to our society. So thank you so much for speaking to us today.
That's all from us in this episode of Refugee Nights. Make sure to tune in here on YouTube or follow the link below for our next episode on Tuesday, 1st of December at 7 p.m., which will look at how refugees have forged new lives in new destinations throughout history. There's lots more to watch on the IWM YouTube channel, so please do make sure to like and subscribe. Special thanks to our sponsors, Macfarlanes, and partners, AHRC and ESRC, and our media partner, CNN. I am Hassan Akkad, this is Refugee Nights, and we're looking forward to seeing you next week.